Everybody's next to her, Butch Patrick. Yay! Yay. Yay. Come on, folks, are you Munsters? Yay! Yay? Counting us up? That's a little bit. Awesome. So, do you want to go ahead and take questions now? I have some questions, or do you all want to do some questions? Do you want to start out here? Do you want to go over there? Which way would you like to go?
Well, first of all, I'd like to welcome everybody to Scarefest 8. Yay, yay, yay. This is Patrick's first trip here, so give her a nice big round of applause.
Have you ever been to Lexington?
No, I've never been to Lexington, nor have I ever done this show. No, and I'm thrilled. I think it's wonderful.
Well, you know what?
I have to tell you what I was so impressed with this show. First of all, how organized it was. How the aisles were wide, how they had long skirts in front of all the tables, how they had drapes along the back, and I know why. Because it's run by three women.
keep the guys out of this, exactly.
That's the first show. This is the first show I have done that have had women that have put on the show. First one in 35 years.
Well, you know, one of the things that I liked, we were commenting about this as we were walking down, was the quality of the vendor tables and the stuff. I mean, there's really neat stuff here, good stuff. I mean, you come, it's an A-list type of thing, and then it's all the way from the top to the bottom. They got, I mean, look at the celebrities they've got here, you know, aside from us, of course, but American Horror Story, the whole cast is practically there, and Fright Night, and just George Romero. I mean, that's really neat stuff, so I'm sure it's gonna be ultra successful show, so I'm really honored that we're like starting off the panels. This is great.
I am too. I think it's wonderful.
So, does anybody have any good questions if you'd like?
Yeah, I can absolutely. Do you want me to go ahead and ask a couple, and then you guys come up with a few? Yeah. And everyone's like, go ahead. Fat guy, first
one.
Yeah,
it's
supportive.
You can do it.
Thank you. So, Butch, I have an obscure question. Is it a rare enough fact that you played Pugsley?
Yeah, there was
on a pilot?
There was a, well,
by the way, I was doing my research.
It was a very short-lived one-shot deal, but believe it or not, they had a really good cast in a remake of the Addams Family. It was called the Addams Family Funhouse. Jack Riley, of Bob Newhart fame, you know, and he played Gomez. Liz Torres, a really good solid actress, played Morticia. Stubby Kay played Uncle Fester, and Pat McCormick, a legendary comedian, played Lurch, believe it or not, and they had me cast as Pugsley, and then a woman named Helen von Sunk was Wednesday Addams. And I make fun of this, but it was so bad that our guest star was Jim Neighbors. And it was, he was wonderful, but it was just such a terrible, it was terribly done, but we did it for a week at CBS, and it was kind of the irony of playing Pugsley Adams as a teenager after doing Eddie Munster was pretty strange, yeah.
I have an obscure question for you. So I was researching you all being a stalker. They basically paid me nothing to do that, but you have to talk about Elvis, and you have to talk about the caddy, and give people a little information about that. Is that all accurate, what I read?
I don't know about the caddy.
Okay,
I read the caddy.
Oh, the caddy!
Oh, I know, that's a car. I mean, I'm thinking of the movie The Caddy, and I'm going, no, I wasn't in that. Okay. I did a movie called Easy Come, Easy Go.
Elvis.
And I often say, well, that's the story of my life. But one day Elvis and I were just, you know, sitting off the set waiting to go on to a scene, and we were just chatting. And I just happened to tell him I was looking for a car. You know, I wanted to buy a car. And he said, well, I'll sell you a car. And I said, well, Elvis, I couldn't afford any car of yours. And I know, I'll make you a good deal. So I said, well, what kind of car is it? And he said, it's a black Eldorado convertible Cadillac. And I went, whoa, that's pretty nice. And I said, how much do you want for it? And he said, $3,000. And I said, sold. So I bought his car. But now, and even the keychain said EP. And another one of my more brilliant investments and moves, I kept it 2 years, and I traded it in for a Pontiac. Not as Elvis's car, not with the keychain, nothing. Nobody, I never said a word. So that was one of the first retirement funds that I threw away.
She even gave the keychain. When I heard that story, I said, I can see you trade the car, okay, you know. But the EP gold keychain, you didn't even bother keeping that to him? No.
I mean, it belonged with the car.
I just, well, do you have anything else? Do you have any interesting stories other than the Cadillac? What was he like? What was he really like?
Well, you know what? Elvis was at the time I worked with him, Priscilla was very much in the picture. However, she never came on this set. I never met her. I never saw her. He had his own entourage of guys. There were 10. And they all performed different functions. But they all came on this set every day. And he had his chef and his manager and his road manager and his music arranger and his best friend and so on and so forth. They all functioned, and very, very nice guys. He was very quiet, he was shy, and he was very religious. He was only after he, you know, got to Vegas and many, many years later that he had a problem. And I don't think, you know, if you understand Vegas life and what they go through and the nights, and he was gaining weight and then taking pills to lose weight and trying to, you know, the shows lasted a long time in Vegas. You can kind of understand how he got caught up in that drug scene, and really not intentionally.
Just hand it back to Butch, you want to talk about your band? You want to talk about your band?
I was doing the band.
Eddie,
you know, it's very funny how someone can have 6 records and really not be a musician or a singer. I like to consider myself
the
original. Well, I consider myself the original Munster Vanilli, because long before Milli Vanilli got caught lip syncing, I was lip syncing in 1971 on American Bandstand, and that was just what people did. They never, nothing was live, and you could get away with actually not having much talent in singing. And although I never really was successful at it, we had a record in 71 and 72 with Sugarloaf, who was my studio band, which was actually a pretty solid band. We did, like I said, American Bandstand. I was actually the headliner over Lockins on the Scene to show you how crazy that business could be. Then, in 1982, when MTV came on the air, I had this wild idea that I wanted to produce rock videos. I loved MTV. I thought it was a very cool thing, and having no talent, again, as musically anyway, I wrote the lyrics to Whatever Happened to Eddie, which was a kind of like a ballad, not really a ballad, more of a song, an upbeat song, to the Munsters theme. And then we put together a studio band, recorded a video, and we actually were the first unsigned act ever to be on MTV. I mean, that sounds like a lot, but back then, music was very much geared and run by who was giving you the money to get the airplay. Payola was huge. So we BS'd our way up the tower at MTV, and we were aired. And from that video, they actually started the Basement Tapes. The funny part about it was we never performed. My bass was played by my producer. The singer was my guitar player, although I lip-synced it. And I have people to this day come up and say, hey, I saw you open the Wilkes-Barre for, you know, God knows what, and you guys were great. And we never performed. But that is my record career in a nutshell. We did it in 83 and 1972, 6 records, never sang a note.
You know, that's very interesting. This is the first time I've heard this story. I've only known Butch for about 51 years. And but what is even more interesting, I did not know that he lip-synced. I got my start lip-syncing. I was 15, and my mother was doing a church road show. And it was a time show that went around at the various churches. We lived in Utah. And she needed an opening curtain act. And everything was timed, and it had to be 3 minutes. So she came up with the brilliant idea that I would lip sync a record for the 3 minutes while they were setting up the scene room. Well, we got this very funny record. There was an old British singer named Beatrice Kay, and the song was, "Hooray, hooray, I'm going away with the man in the little white coat." Well, I came out in front of things like a crazy lady, you know, I had a hat with a bird on it, and did this, and I was, and the whole half of the record is laughing. Well, I'm lip syncing, laughing, and I'm holding myself, and I'm rolling on the floor, and so on. And then, of course, the man in the little white coat come, and they take me away. That was my start.
Well, do we have any questions from the audience then?
Sure.
Sure. Do you want to just yell it out?
What are your fondest memories of being on set with Craig Quinn and with all of them, especially as theater?
Well, when we would go into Monday morning reading to check out the script, the upcoming scenes, I was always very happy when I saw the Munster coach was going to be involved. Well, that was for two reasons. Selfish reasons were I loved the car and I loved, you know, the young boy that I enjoyed riding around in Hot Rods. But the second reason was that meant we would be outside, because most of the shots were always inside a very dark, dingy, dusty soundstage. But the Munster coach was never fired up indoors. We always were outdoors. So that, to me, was always a high spot when I knew we would be outside at least one day in the car. That was my fun stuff.
My most memorable times were the 3 days that we filmed. I would always go to lunch with Fred and Alan, the commissary. And of course, everyone was in costume but me. And I would always sit in the middle and we'd have lunch. And you know, people would come up to me afterward and say, "Ooh, how can you sit there and have lunch and eat with these people? Isn't it weird?" And I said, you know, it just goes to show when you take the time, when you get to know someone, doesn't make any difference if they're green, if they're weird, if they're whatever. We would sit and talk about our children and what we did last night and so on. So that was my most memorable time.
Lisa Lauren's here. Let's give her a hand. Miss Lauren. Miss Lauren, I've been asking questions, everybody, and you are now getting here. Do you mind if I ask you one? Okay. Now, I was reading when I was doing some research on you that you won't do schlock. So first thing I want to know is your definition about schlock. And the second thing is you want to do a Tarantino film, is what I read. Is that true?
God, I don't know why you said that. Well, I studied with Tarantino.
Oh, really?
We went to acting school together.
Okay.
Yeah, and depending on what it is. And schlock, it depends upon what it is, what the material's about, whether something I'm interested in.
Okay. What kind of character would you like to play in Tarantino? You got kind of like in your head, you want to be the
like
badass, or do you
maybe
want to be
what like Rosanna, Patty Arquette did in True Love?
Yeah, True Romance.
True Romance.
Yeah, yeah. That's cool. All right. Do you want to ask the same question, sir, to her as well, that you just asked?
Oh, there's so many of them I can't even begin to tell you, because I worked with a group of people that were so phenomenal, cast and crew. There was never a bad moment. They always went out of their way to make us happy, the kids, Kenny and I. Unfortunately, Kenny passed away last December. But, you know, I mean, it's just, I had no bad experiences until I left the show and went back to school. And then I was teased and picked on, and, you know, because there wasn't a lot of children actors at that time on television. Now there's one on every show almost, but not back then.
Okay, we have another question.
Yeah, I actually asked this earlier. All three of you, so young, and you start with such talent. I mean, Giovanni Carlo, Fred Wynn, you had Carol Jones. I mean, that must have been some experience when you were so young. I mean, I'm sure they were like really lovely people. But is there anything you can tell us maybe about Carol Jones and your interaction on the set?
Carol and
questions do we have? All right, I have a couple more then. I'll keep asking them. I'm sure that you guys get this a lot as far as someone walks up, the show meant this much to me, I watched it with my family, it brought us together. I'm sure you've heard all this. Can any of you share maybe one that's particularly in your head of a story that someone shared with you that maybe was really beautiful or kind of melted your heart and go, oh, that's great?
Well, I think, you know, you never know how a show is perceived until you come out and you meet the fans, and they come up and they share their experiences, you know, how, and I think it's one of the most touching things are when people come up and say, well, you know, I can remember when all of our family used to watch together, and now my family is gone. And, you know, it's just heartwarming to think that, you know, you provided people with some good memories because they provided us with good memories.
And now everybody watches shows, different shows. Families don't watch them together because of all the cable channels. And
there were only the three networks.
Yeah.
It was funny, the other day I was Daytona, and I've been touring around the country with my cars and stuff, doing a lot of car-related stuff. And of all places, I'm going to this radio station. This young girl who was working the information, you know, the first walk-in reception, came up to me, and she gave me the greatest compliment that I had in a long, long time, and I had the opportunity with it. She said, when I was a little girl, I had a really bad bout with depression. And she says, and you were my imaginary friend that got me through my darkest times. And she goes, I'd like to thank you for being there, because when nobody was around, you were my friend. And I thought, how sweet is that, that you can have that kind of contact with people you don't even know, and here you are, you know, and she's an attractive woman, and she's about 22 or 23. But I was someone that she got through her depression with. I thought that was the sweetest could be.
The same for me, in different ways. People have come up to me and said, the Addison, that made my day. Problems, and it brought them into the light, because, you know, I mean, these were dark, serious shows. Like, the Addams Family movies were dark and morose, not witty, intelligent humor like the Addams Family, you know. So, anyway, it was all gratifying, and
you know, a lot of times, because of the Munsters and the Addams Family, we were on not the same night, but approximately the same time, and of course at the same year. And I'll come out and do shows, and our people will come up to me and say, oh, I just loved you on the Addams Family, I loved you with the parades. I'm going, no, that's not me. I'm a lot older than the beautiful Lisa, but I've had a lot of fun with people mixing us up. We can understand that.
We have a question right there, sir.
I just turned 53, and I have such a hard time watching all the new stuff on TV because of the quality of both the Addams Family and the Munsters and anything River. Is there a reason why that I noticed the quality and other people notice the quality of some of the older style?
Yes, in my opinion, there is, and this comes from a lot of people that are smarter than I am, that are in the production of movies and television, that are just, you know, they shared this knowledge with me. Basically, I wasn't really aware that in the 50s, when, you know, TV was really in its infancy and people considered it the golden age, it was really just, they were filming radio, and the sitcom hadn't really come into its own until the 60s. And when it did come into its own, during the early and mid-60s, when the Addams and the Munsters were on, including a lot of other shows like Mr. Ed and My Favorite Martian and I Dream of Jeannie and Bewitched, all these non-reality-based shows. You know, these were shows that were just written by great comedy writers with great comedians early in their career when they were doing television. So you had this pool of funny writing and great acting all put into this thing in this new venue, which was television. And three channels would come out at 7:30 at night. People would come home to watch TV dinners and just be to be entertained.
Yeah.
just to be entertained. They were all getting around. This was the entertainment portal for the time. And it was the 60s. I mean, it was a better time of life. It was, the quality of life was better back then. There's so many contributing factors that it's tough. I mean, I really feel sorry for kids growing up today. I'm glad I grew up in the 60s and the 50s and the early 70s, because I think that was a wonderful window of opportunity. And I feel kind of sad that a lot of that is lost, but thank God for Netflix and DVDs and MeTV and all the other shows and channels that keep the old shows like us alive. But I think that's the reason for the staying power. It was just good quality acting, good writing, and a better time to remember.
Yeah, there's never been anything done like these shows since. No,
I think another thing of the during the 60s, what shows we're talking about, they had great writers, wonderful comedy writers. And, you know, we had shows, even though we were a weird family, we were also a functional family. We went to school, mother and dad, your meals. Now, and this is just my opinion, now they're taking dysfunctional families and portraying as the normal. And so our whole so-called normal is changed. It's not the same. And in a lot of, not just family, but in a lot of things.
Other questions?
It's funny, I was in Tennessee recently and the Fall Out Boys were going to be playing in Nashville, and they contacted us, wanted us to do a video featuring the car and this and that, and I was on the road and they were on the road, and we couldn't get in the same place at the same time. But I thought it was hilarious because it was really cool because it's Pulp Fiction, she wants to dance like Uma Thurman with a Munsters riff, and I had come up with the idea with these guys. I said, you know, we could do a dance contest at a nightclub. Have the Munster coach deliver the people to the concert. We can get your video. You know, I can get paid, you can get your video, and we can have a really cool Pulp Fiction dance contest. Because how hard would it be to everybody dress up like Uma Thurman and John Travolta and do the twist? But we just couldn't quite pull it off. But to answer your question, yeah, I really like the song.
You haven't heard it? We will have to play it for after this panel is over, right?
I live in Idaho. It takes a while for things to get there.
We live in Kentucky. However, I will say Lexington's not quite Kentucky, but it's definitely not more. So let's not make those jokes. Butch, do you mind talking about your cars?
My car, not sure.
4 years ago, I was doing a Halloween tour, and they sent a gentleman in a Munster coach to come pick me up. And I looked out the window and I go, you're not going to believe this guy's dressed as grandpa, he's in the Munster coach. And we became friends. We did a lot of appearances over the last 4 years. And earlier this year, he wanted to sell them. So we came to terms and I wound up buying the Munster coach and the Dracula. And now I'm kind of doing what I really enjoy, which is car-related industries and shows and Comic-Cons and events like this. But with the cars in tow, it kind of gives me a whole new direction to do gearhead type stuff. So I'm keeping busy with the cars. It's a lot of fun and they're a great display. So if you get a chance, come out and take a picture with them and feel free to look around. And thank you. Yeah, I'm doing what I really enjoy doing. I'm having a good time. It's a lot of work. I have a lot more respect for the people that come into these shows now and have to set up and load in and load out, because that's I used to laugh at them. They would say, boy, my God, I don't have to do that. Well, guess what? I'm doing it. But at the end of the day, it's a great deal of a sense of satisfaction.
You brought it up and it did not come up in my research, but the Tarantino thing. I am a big fan, so I don't want to hear a story, but what I do like to hear is a big fan, never made a bad movie. However, I think if I was in a room with him for 20 minutes, I may strangle him. Did you feel that way? Would you like to talk about it?
No, I never felt that way. He was the weirdo who sat in the back of the acting class. He was like, no fucking glasses on. He never even did a single. He's a producer and a writer. He's really not an actor.
Yeah.
And he came out with a whole new genre that we know today.
Oh, well, I was hoping there would be a really good story. All right.
No! And he was a weirdo.
Pat, you've talked before about the first time, the first few times someone asked you for your autograph, you just couldn't fathom why. Do you still feel that way?
Well, I'm always overwhelmed at, you know, people. You know, I was saying to my husband, you know, it's really not difficult to leave Idaho and go do these shows and be adored for the weekend. It's kind of nice, you know. But it amazes me, and it amazes me how long the show's been on the air now, 52 years, and still, I mean, we've become cult as the Addams Family, and it's just, I'm amazed all the time.
Yes.
All the time. Is that the same for the other two as well? That's right. We've got to play that before. Well, I read while I was researching this, she was really taken back the first few times, and we thought, why would anybody want my autograph? Because I think I would feel the same way. Do you all feel that way? Have you gotten past that? Are you just accustomed to it? People stop you, people ask it, or do you ever feel, why in the hell does anybody want my autograph? No, why would they? Does that make sense?
You know, it's funny. I learned probably from what I consider to be one of the best was Al Lewis. And Al Lewis was a very intelligent guy, but he would walk through the airport because he just looked like Grandpa with or without his makeup. I kind of have the best of both worlds. I can pretty much go anywhere I want to go without, occasionally, sure, people will recognize, not too often enough to keep you on your toes, but not that often to where it becomes an annoyance. And at the same time, when you do the shows like this particular show, you know, I enjoy meeting the fans. For me, it's very entertaining. I enjoy it, I look forward to it. And I kind of feed off the fact that I'm lucky enough to have people come up and I put a smile on their face, and they put a smile on my face, and everybody's a feel-good situation. And at the end of the day, you know, if you sell some merchandise and you have a good time and you make a few bucks, that's icing on the cake. But the bottom line is, it's neat to be part of somebody's, this extended family that you have through this magic box that you're on 50 years ago. I mean, I worked from 61 to 72 mostly, and it's funny that the 10-year window in pop culture in the 60s has kind of shaped my life, but I don't have a problem with it. I'm happy with it, I enjoy it, I'm glad I was Eddie Munster, I'm glad I have a fan base, and I'm glad I was on a very successful show that people seem to really enjoy. How could you not like that?
That's a really good question.
Well, living in Idaho, I don't like people to know that I was Marilyn on the Munsters. It embarrasses me. Why? I don't know. But I don't want people to say anything about it. I want to be able to go to the market in my sweatsuit and no makeup. You know, sometimes I've gone in my house slippers. I don't care. But all of a sudden, when people know, oh, she's Marilyn on the Munster, then they expect more of you.
Is it?
Yes.
Same question. How do you feel about, being Wednesday?
Well, I feel really good about being Wednesday.
Okay.
But I was so young, people don't recognize me unless they've seen me on the soap or a talk show. So popular for many years, as mm-hmm. real terms. And I mainly feel really proud and really privileged to have been part of such an iconic show. Who knew? It has a life of its own. It's never ending.
Sure.
Any other questions? All right, in the back. Anybody on the sets that pulled any kind of pranks, anything like that? I'm assuming Butch was the one pulling the prank.
Where do you want to start? Jackie Coogan did it all the time. He'd fall asleep during the middle of someone's tape, snoring in the background. And John and Carolyn, I mean, they were nonstop pranks. And they were the funniest, sweetest people, the greatest people. Friend,
Gwen and now Lewis were always putting each other on. I was kind of naive to the whole thing, and they were always putting me on. I never knew the truth the entire time I worked the show. I never knew their age, whatever they told me. I think everything they told me was a lie. I mean, whatever they wanted to tell me.
When there was a prop man, a very nice little guy named Eddie Keys on our show, Eddie, his job was to, at night, make whatever models or whatever toys you needed to be used the next day in the set. And Fred would always break the first one. I mean, whatever it was, he would always bust Eddie's chops by breaking whatever this poor guy had and would stay up all night making. So Eddie always had to make two of them. There would always be two, whatever was in the model airplane or whatever was in the lab, whatever. And he would beg Fred, please, Fred, we've only got two. And Fred would break the first one, which would mean the second one had to be the right one. And we would always usually get it on the first take, or never the second take, because he'd broken the first one in rehearsal. And that's what I remember, because Eddie had a tough job keeping Fred and Fred's sense of humor in check somewhat.
Anybody? Yes, right here in the front.
No, actually, they rehearsed a lot. So before we actually went to film, they were pretty sure, because film was very expensive back then, and they would want to get it on the first take because the developing it was pricey. But we actually had the two guys that were our special effects gentlemen, Chuck and Davey. I don't know if you know this, Pat, but they both went on. One went over to Lucasfilm, and the other one went over to Spielberg. Yeah, and they both individually, they worked together on our show. Even though we had really old school type special effects that was cutting edge for the time, they both went on to have stellar careers with Lucas and Spielberg individually.
And Lisa, I have one last question for you.
Okay.
So you were interviewed by probably what some people consider the best interviewer of all time. You want to talk about, say, she knows what I'm going to say. You want to talk about dealing with Howard? Howard Stern?
He was a complete gentleman.
That's what I mean.
He understood everything I said. Now, had I pulled a punch in trouble, he would have had me for lunch. But I didn't. I was completely honest, and that's all I wanted. And he was wonderful. Unlike Geraldo, who was a piece of
cake. Oh my goodness, did you say S-H-I-T? Okay, that's okay. We don't have too many kids here. Nobody's too sensitive. So, but I've heard that. Roger Ebert said that Howard Stern is the best person to interview anyone.
I was expected to be, hung out to dry and made my, eat lunch. And he treated me, because of that, I was completely honest.
Other questions? Well, I'm out of questions. What do you all want to talk about? Where are we at on time? We've got a few minutes. Is there any stories you'd like to share? Or do you want to go back to your tables?
And I got Fall Out Boy as well.
And we got Fall Out Boy. Right, so when we're done, we're going to hold it over the microphone, so if anybody's missed it, absolutely. Any more questions? Come on, folks. This is
young.
For you, right? It was the longest. It took forever.
That was one of the perks for having three lines. It's the fact that I was only in makeup for half an hour, and at the end of filming, the end of the day, I could get in my car, get on the freeway, and go home. These others, no. 2 hours to get into the makeup and about an hour and a half to get out of it.
You know, it's funny, I had about an hour, which really wasn't too bad. And the neat part about going to makeup was, we have several of the face-off makeup people here, right?
Right.
Well, Mike Westmore, who is the father of Mackenzie, you know, Westmore, who hosts that show and comes on the show often as the mentor, he was my makeup man as an apprentice. And
really?
I idolized this guy. I mean, he was young, he was handsome, he drove a Jaguar, he wore an ascot. I mean, and you know, when you get to know your makeup person, it's like being in the barber chair for an hour, you know? You sit there, and Mike became a really dear friend. He's still a good friend of mine. And he let me, when I wasn't working, I would go up to the lab, and I would see what he was working on. I had first-hand preview. You know, this is good stuff. This is like early days of really great monster-making, neat stuff. And Mike, you know, he won an Oscar for Mask, and he's one of the best. That was really, I looked forward to makeup. It was like, that was my hour to really hang around a guy that I really admired. And then when I wasn't busy, I had a chance to really enjoy a lot of the good things that Universal had to offer, which was special effects, backlot, the lab with the makeup. So for me, I'm looking forward to seeing these guys do their stuff, because I was, you know, I was taught by the, I was worked on by the best. I shouldn't say I was taught, but it was fun for me.
That's not bad. Oh, you want to say that? She won't.
When we first started the show, we had a real problem with makeup. They were using a process called grease paint, and they would paint it on in the morning and put a lot of powder on it, and it would crack within 3 or 4 hours. It just wasn't holding up, and they would have to do it again and again. And finally, Max Factor came up with a pant stick that was a color that was working, and then once they got that down, basically you got through most of the day. After lunch, you had some touch-ups around your mouth, but most of the time you could get through with just basic light maintenance throughout the day, pretty much.
I think, not for me, but I think one of the hardest things in talking with Yvonne and Fred was what the makeup did to their skin. I mean, getting out of it every day, that gray makeup and wearing it all day long, very hard on the skin.
Luckily, the one thing that made it tolerable was that we only filmed 3 days a week. So if you get to Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, at least you had, you know, like you say, your skin, being a kid, you know, acne and stuff. But luckily, we had 4 days without makeup. So that's the only way it was tolerable. If we would have done that 5 days a week, it probably wouldn't have never happened.
We have a question right here.
Yeah, one last question. It's actually more towards thank God they didn't do a lot with the Munsters, but, you know, after the show ended, like every 5 years, they'd have a Adam's Family Halloween special or blah, 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 with all these different actors doing it.
Only one.
Really? There's only one, I think, for sure, there was one. But then there was also and then we had movies, and what did you think about Christina Ricci and she was
13? I thought she was wonderful. They just went a much different way. They went, it was more dark, more morose, where the Addams Family had more witty humor.
Did you catch the
humor? Our executive producer and head writer, Matt Perrin, came out to Hollywood to write for the Marx Brothers.
Really? Awesome. Did you catch 1313 Mockingbird Light? It was on for like
it was a pilot that didn't want to go to. Yeah. I didn't see it.
That was
there.
Right.
Yeah. Did either of you see that? It was it was a couple of years ago. The same guy, Brian Fuller, the guy that did Hannibal and a few other shows, did a pilot. I think they only showed the pilot for NBC and it never went anywhere.
What, Mockingbird Lake? Yeah. I actually went on the last day of the shoot on that set with Brian Fuller, Brian Singer, and. I wish I still had this picture because Ian McKellen was on the set that day. And it was pretty cool meeting this guy. He had no idea he'd be there. And I introduced the show, I actually introduced it at San Diego Comic-Con that year to good reviews, to good response from the fans, and the ratings really weren't that bad on its premiere. But Universal's strange about the Munster. They have a real problem greenlighting anything about it and or letting it out for rerun situation or syndication because they hold it very tight. And you don't see it very often. So I was hoping it would get picked up because I had a recurring role in it. And I thought it was pretty good. And they had a good cast. I thought Portia de Rossi was wonderful. And Jerry O'Connell. And Eddie Izzard. It was good. But not to be.
Well,
Why is Universal so, do you have any idea why Universal? Because the Munsters is so, I guess you wouldn't call it protective.
You know, I don't know, it's just, they're difficult. Just, there's a toy coming out right now that they've spent over a year and a half just trying to find the right place where they can manufacture it. I mean, they're just really, really weird when it comes to green lighting anything or licensing stuff. So I've heard horror stories from people that just have very difficult times working with Universal.
An interesting thing, which you may or may not know, none of us have received residuals. We worked under the old union contract, and I've been on the air 52 years. We worked the shows of the 60s. Under the union contract, it was 7 reruns per episode. And that was used up in the first 2 years. So for the last 51 years, I mean, it's been on the air, and we've received nothing. This is where the producers make the money now, because they don't have to pay
anything. That's why you actually do a part of the show now. All the actors and all the big shows are executive, co-executive producers. They own a piece of it. So they're going to make money forever. As long as it's shown.
But then in 1970, they came in with new contracts that covered all the, everybody gets residuals, but they didn't, was it 73, early 70s, but then they did not grandfather any of us, any of the shows of the 60s.
Class action lawsuit, all the money went to the directors and writers.
Yeah, being an actor is not probably the most profitable way to go about it. But, you know, then again, it was, like you say, the 60s, and nobody foresaw syndication, nobody foresaw this. It was, you know, how do you protect it, especially when you're a kid. It's one thing as an adult, and as a kid, you just, the standard contracts, or the standard contracts. But then again, I look at doing what I'm doing right now as my residuals, so I'm a happy camper.
So, if we don't have any more questions, do you want to play the song for everybody?
Let's do it.
Let's do it.
This is it.
Big round of applause for Butch, Pat Cruz, and Lisa Lauren. Thank you so much.